Our program to bring you a special broadcast. The German news agency...
We interrupt this program to bring you a news bulletin from Washington.
Special report, verdict sparks violence. National Guard troops are standing by, ready to patrol the streets of Los Angeles, rocked by widespread violence.
My name's Alex Jones. I'm a radio and television host in Austin, Texas. And for many years, I've been exposing the criminal activities of the global elite, otherwise known as the New World Order. These folks don't make their money out of the production of goods and services or via creativity. They make their money and their stock and trade is slavery, control of populations. In the next 2 hours, you will see hardcore documentation, evidence that is irrefutable that America is turning into a nightmarish police state. Cameras on the street corners, mass checkpoints on our major interstate highways, warrantless searches. But worst of all, you'll see America's military being perverted, being turned into an instrument of control, not an instrument of defense. I have footage, and you're going to see it, of Marines engaging in mock gun confiscations, kicking in doors, setting up concentration camps, and working with foreign troops from China, Russia, Britain, Australia. It's incredible, my friends. And you've got to face up to it. I've got to face up to it, and we've got to take action. But perhaps worst of all is the Delta Force, Army Special Operations from Fort Bragg, North Carolina, slamming into South Texas towns during Operation Last Dance. Buildings ablaze, power lines down, live fire exercises, the citizenry terrorized. Again, this isn't some foreign country. This is America. Psychological warfare against the population. Why are armored personnel carriers being delivered every week to small towns and big cities? Not for the military, but for police. Why is the military training with our police? And what's happening? My friends, this is the battle for the Republic. The enemy is not our police, and it's not our military. It is those that would pervert and twist the sacred oath that our peace officers and military folks have sworn to uphold. That is to defend our country from enemies foreign and domestic. It's up to you. This whole criminal system, this whole undertaking that we see unfolding before our eyes is done through ignorance. It's up to you to educate the cop that lives next door to you, or to talk to your friend who's a captain or a colonel or a general or a private in the United States military. It's up to you to educate them about what's happening and refresh their memory about history. We are repeating what happened in 1933 Germany. My friends, it's up to you. In the next 2 hours, again, you're going to see the documentation. It's irrefutable. And I challenge you to research the information you'll see borne out in this documentary. Here are just a few of the scenes you'll see in the next 2 hours. So sit back and educate yourselves about what's happening to our nation. As I said, it is a battle for the Republic.
How you doing, sir?
Well, thank you.
Having a good time?
Yes.
How's it going over at the camp?
Oh, pretty well. Guys are in a bit exercises now. They do very well.
So the camp situation's going good with the disarmament and things?
Oh, yeah.
Because we saw them over there disarming people. Is that what the exercise is?
Yeah, exercise now, yeah.
Fantastic. Where are you from, sir?
From Holland.
Oh, okay.
From the best Marines.
Fantastic. Come on,
to get to the town mayor. She's in a meeting.
Okay, let's go ahead and bring those two in.
Let's go.
Attention, attention, attention. American forces are here to help. Remain calm. We will not tolerate civil disobedience.
So what'd you see? What'd you hear?
Well, they were throwing some bombs, you know, bombing. Right. Yeah. And some, I think they were using some rifles too, and the other kind of rifles, you know, the one you stuff like that.
Looking out your window and seeing unmarked helicopters and troops dressed in ninja black suits with assault rifles, it's kind of spooky.
Waffen SS.
I wouldn't have said that, Alex.
Get it on.
I got it.
Get the searchlights.
Jawohl, my friend.
Jawohl! Warrantless random searches on America's interstate highways. We think this is as good a place as any to start our story. I know what some of you are thinking, though. You're thinking, hey, there must have been a child molester or an axe murderer loose. No, my friends, these are warrantless, random searches. All part of being guilty until proven innocent. The checkpoints. Brought to you by something as innocuous, at least seemingly, as the presidential initiative on seatbelt use. The Clinton administration's supposed liberals allotted over $2 billion plus dollars for 1999 alone for nationwide Nazi behavior. But not just the socialists and the Democratic Party. Oh no, the Republicans and the Supreme Court have been backing warrantless searches of anybody the police feel like pulling over and harassing. Again, in a police state, police don't have to work very hard. But in a republic,
In a country with freedom, they do. This is not an attack on the police. It's a cry for help to every American. Now we're about to go out and speak to some of the police and expose what they're doing and hopefully reactivate their conscience.
We are entering the eye of the checkpoint. Caution, reduce speed, checkpoint ahead. Isn't that loving, children? Got a nice big generator running that. Well, here's the love, ladies and gentlemen. America, here to take care of you. This happens all the time right here in Austin, Texas. Just south of Austin, to be exact. Well, there's the command unit over there. Nice big Winnebago. Ah, shining their lights in people's face. Hello, Waffen SS.
I would have said that, Alex.
Get the searchlights.
Jawohl, my friend.
Jawohl. We're going to go back through the gauntlet, and we've got them just pulling them back, pulling them off down there, pulling them off here, all part of Bill Clinton's funding, and they love it. We're exiting, we're turning around, we're going down the access road this time. There's another one right there. A little too fast.
Or look at the traffic they got backed up, Alex. Just look at it.
But I hope you can take care of
it. All right, here we go. Look at the traffic they got backed up. It is monumental. Now this night vision camera comes in. Just line it up.
Oh my God, we are in a police thing. What?
All right, let's go.
Get it.
Okay. Yes, sir. I'm a syndicated talk show host. I also make documentaries. I'm out here covering this. Let's walk on down, Hanson.
You go. You lead the way.
Come on, Lizard. I'm sure to come over here in a second.
Good. Hey, this night vision works good.
Here it is, my friends. America. $2.4 billion by Bill Clinton, 1999, for federal checkpoints, federal funding. You're seeing MJTF right now, police from all different counties in Central Texas and Austin, working together, bringing you the police state. It's going to get a lot worse. The war against guns is raging. We're in 1936 Germany right now. Trying to interview one. How much time we got left on the battery?
57.
Here we go, guys. We're getting shined on right here.
Good job.
Well, we're getting the lights shined on us by the, black uniforms, everything. This is incredible. This is incredible. There, look at that aggressive behavior. Okay, guys, America is in deep trouble. Hey, are y'all MJTF? Is this an MJTF operation?
Actually, we're
off the street.
We're Serbian soldiers over here in the United States taking over.
Clint, do you even know where this funding comes from?
To be honest with you, I'm still on the hunt.
Yeah. This stuff is real, sir.
Yeah.
And y'all can rationalize what you're doing. There'll be more decisions for you in the future.
We made it out there at about 11 p.m. The checkpoint had been going since 6 p.m. that night during peak traffic time on I-35. So we walked on over and asked the officers a few questions just to find out if they had any idea what they were engaging in. Because remember, this whole thing is run out of ignorance.
How you doing? Oh, my name's Alex Jones, syndicated talk show host. How you doing? Oh, thank you very much. Yeah, well, we're just curious about the different details of this multi-jurisdictional task force operation here. Or is this just an Austin operation?
Lieutenant Klofner is in charge.
Where is he?
Somewhere around here.
Yeah, we can talk to him for like 2 minutes.
He's way back by your van, and I'll find him.
Okay. How many people have y'all apprehended?
Drugs?
move across the street, sir?
Across the street.
All right, so because we're not picking blue bonnets and we can't be here.
Across the street.
Understand. Thank you very much.
Not picking blue bonnets.
You know, I used to want to be a tough one. So easy. It's not America anymore.
Escorted.
Well, y'all told me I could talk to your superior, and I'll be waiting over here. Thank you. Thank you very much. Like the new black uniform.
Okay.
Pirates are wearing his combat. Oh, he's wearing his combat boots. Get a shot. We like that. Hey, yeah. According to the Texas code, you're not uniformed, but hey, who cares about rules? Let's get on this today. I tell you, this is it, guys. They're laughing. Get shots up. They're over there
Where?
Laughing about the death of this country. Look at them. Over there laughing about the death of our nation.
I got it.
Over there thinking it's funny. You guys want to clean the drugs off the street? Go after the CIA. You guys want to clean the drugs off the street? Go after the government. I wouldn't use that government filth for $1 million, but I won't lose my liberties, my God-given rights. Total cowards. Total, complete cowards. Going along to get along. That is shameful right here in Texas. Right here in Texas. My God. Yeah, they get their $30,000 to $40,000 a year, their 20 pieces of silver to sell us down the river. Boy, pensions and the rest of it. Selling our country out. God. What are we doing, sir? Well, I'm a two-headed radio talk show host and Alex Jones. How you doing?
Okay.
What's your name, sir?
Shane.
This is night vision camera. Sir, this is reminiscent of Nazi Germany.
I'll get somebody to talk to you about that. Who are on the left?
Well, they were telling us the person in charge would come.
I'll get him.
Okay.
Look left. Left. Where?
Oh, here we go. Yeah, the pack mentality. Yes. Yes. Deal with it. Nice crew cut. Why don't you fight for America? We've been asking for an interview for 30, 40 minutes, and they're just standing over there. And the head guy walked over and then ran off, and I talked about how they're a bunch of Nazis. I didn't call them Nazis. I just said it was Nazi-like activity. Nazi-like activity. You know, the whole city, people just love it.
Look, I'm shot. Oh, they're shining right in their face. Look at that. And he follows them along, too, Alex. Look how they follow him along.
Inside the car.
So what? Look how he follows them along.
Doing a fine job there.
See the people, they wave, little scared sheep. Yeah, I didn't wave.
And the reason we didn't wave is because we're not going to sanction this behavior. Culturally, we have to explain that it's not to be condoned because it's a slippery slope, my friends.
Doesn't this kind of seem like Nazi Germany to you? I mean, aren't we innocent until proven guilty instead of guilty until proven innocent?
I couldn't talk with you about this, sir. I'm just out of doing my job.
It's just your job?
Yes, sir.
Hey, well, you know who else said that?
Who said that?
Well, at Nuremberg.
Okay. They just really need us to take a break.
All right. Thanks. How many folks you pulled over tonight?
I'm not on this end.
A lot of traffic stops tonight? Oh, you've made three personally. We appreciate that, sir. Thank you. Well, that's a nice black sedan. You say we ought to talk to them. Man, all these federal funds coming in for this. I thought in America we were innocent until proven guilty. Are we innocent until proven guilty?
Are you guilty of something?
No, I'm not guilty of anything.
Oh, I thought you were asking me, were you innocent until proven guilty?
But I mean, aren't we all supposed, you know, in this country, you know, other countries like Germany under Hitler wasn't that way, or under Stalin it wasn't that way, but here in America, aren't we supposed to be innocent until proven guilty?
That's true.
That's true. There you go. Talk to us. Well, I mean, I don't hate police or anything, but at the same time, you got to wonder, this is happening all over the country now because the federal funds that are flowing. I mean, isn't that interesting?
You're talking to the wrong person.
Talking to the wrong person?
You're talking to the wrong person.
Gentlemen, what's y'all's names? I'm just curious.
My name is Johnson.
How you doing, sir?
Good to talk to you. Y'all like the sedan?
Oh, that's all right.
What do y'all call these units? I see a lot of these around town. Just an unmarked police unit. Did they call y'all in and tell you the procedure?
As far as what?
Well, basically, how do they pick people out of the crowd to pull over? That's what we're curious
about. I don't know. If you go down right over there and talk to one of them supervisors, they can tell you everything about
it. They're busy, huh?
They didn't tell y'all the... basically, they just called y'all and told them to pull over.
Well, you go right over there and talk to the supervisor and tell you all about it. I'm just out here doing my job, brother.
Okay.
They can tell you all the procedures. So they put it together. We did.
You guys are just doing your jobs?
Right.
All right. Well, I'm not attacking y'all. But hey, think about this. There may come a time when you see some things on television that are manufactured by government. They're asking y'all to do some things that don't really sound right, but in the rush of everything, everybody working together, feeling like y'all are part of a team, going along with some things that aren't good. And just the whole thing's accelerating. Well, that's got to drive us. There's a lot of things accelerating in the world today that aren't too nice. Alex, would you guys, if ordered to do so, would y'all confiscate guns from law-abiding citizens or go house to house?
Who would order you to do something that's against the law?
It's against the law. Well, they're talking about changing that.
Well, I mean, if they change the law, that's what the law says.
How do they change the law without changing the Constitution?
I don't know. You've got to talk to Congress about that one.
Well, yeah, the president uses those executive orders. Well, guys, there'll be some interesting times ahead for everybody.
Two important points. He said go back and talk to his superiors. We were there for over 2.5 hours. And the second point, these two gentlemen, probably decent people, at least they talk to us, don't realize that an unconstitutional law does not have to be obeyed. In fact, I could hearken back to Rosa Parks going to jail for not sitting at the back of the bus. It was the law that black people were slaves, but later it was found to be unconstitutional. Laws are not holy. Laws are not magical if handed down by some despotic, out-of-control police state. Well, we were now on the other side of the highway, and we were talking to some of the truckers about what was going on. The police continually were keying down on the CB. Here's just a little bit of this activity. It's the junior high mentality of our law enforcement personnel that is the most frightening aspect. It's a big game. Go back. Well, absolutely. All our newest nuclear weapons designs have been transferred to China. 5,000 pounds of plutonium came up missing. It goes on and on. America is under attack, my friends. This is just the start of what's happening. And Bill Clinton is funding this with $2.4 billion that he got passed just last year. Not long if these police are such cowards and keep keying down on radios because they don't want to hear the truth like little junior high kids.
It's them laughing. Hey, let me tell you something, police. I'm not afraid of you. You're a bunch of criminals. You're a bunch of weaklings. I'm ashamed to be a part of this country because of people like you.
That's the police.
Well, have fun, police. You're an idiot. You're an idiot. Well, Chief Ali Phillips in San Antonio isn't an idiot when he threw the Delta Force out in May, but you won't research that. Hey, what's going on, guys?
Don't you ever rap?
You're about to see an interview we conducted in mid-May in 1998 with the Chief of Police of San Antonio, Texas, Chief Ali Phillips. The chief was very concerned about what he called the attempts at bribery by Army Special Operations Delta Force. Also, the endangerment of public safety. All very serious issues. This interview is a watershed event because, as far as we know, this is the first time that local law enforcement, local police leadership has actively stood up against Bill Clinton's new military, or the globalist New World Order type military, where they come into towns and terrorize the public. Again, God bless Chief Ali Phillips.
What were your major reservations in asking the mayor to tell them that y'all didn't want them to train here and to cease training here?
Well, a lot of things happened. First of all, the organization came into the city and never really approached the city as a whole. In other words, gotten together with the mayor and said, we need to speak to all these different departments and request some assistance. Various groups and individuals came into the city and approached different people at different levels. The police department was contacted, the city manager's office was contacted about using city facilities, various business owners were contacted through the economic development department, the fire department was contacted by different individuals. So there was never any coordinated approach to the city of San Antonio. When we found out of that, we had some reservations, but we were willing at least to listen. But then we started finding out that discussions were happening at other different levels, and there was no communication, no coordination between that. We also found out that leases had been negotiated with private business people throughout the city to utilize their vacant buildings without any coordination with the police department, because we were originally told there were probably going to be a couple of locations, and later on we find out that there's 12 locations. And yet we were never brought into this at the beginning.
Why did the mayor, and I heard this quoted on KTSA, San Antonio 550 station, 2 days ago, I heard it quoted that the mayor said that he didn't appreciate the dishonesty of the Delta Force. I was curious. We called the mayor's office, and Jackie O'Donnell, I believe is her name, she told us that you were the mayor's spokesman on this. Can you tell us exactly why the mayor would use such strong language and call them dishonest?
Well, I think that there were various approaches. For example, when I originally said no several weeks ago, matter of fact, a couple of months ago, but no was never no. And then no was never no. End of runs were done around to various community leaders. I had someone...
Excuse me, sir. You're saying that they ignored the police chief, and under our Constitution, you're the same as the sheriff, and you run the city or the county. You're telling me that Delta Force was ignoring your order?
Well, I don't want to say they ignored it, but in a roundabout way, yes, because what they would do, once I said no, they went to various individuals in the community to bring pressure to bear to get me to change my mind. For example, there was a community leader who I have a great deal of respect for, and we have a very good relationship that they went to. I get a call from him, and he says, Chief, there's some people in here that they're in town, and it was part of their role here. Didn't say who it was. They need to meet with the mayor and the police chief. Well, of course, this gentleman, I've worked very closely with him on a number of projects. I said, sure, have him give me a call. Now, I'd already said no. Well, then I find out it's the same group. So they identified somebody apparently that I know that's very high in the community to make an approach to me and get me to change my mind. Well, then when we said no, then some elected officials were contacted to bring pressure to bear. And then offers were made to give money, cash money, to elected officials' charities if they could get us to change our minds. I mean, as one of my deputy chiefs said, in some circles that's called bribery.
Well, it is called bribery, but more importantly, it's called manipulation of the constitutional system and the takeover of local police departments.
You talked about a memo from Delta Force?
Yeah, because what happened is various elected officials were being contacted. I have 10 city council members and a mayor, and I just wanted to alert them as to what was happening, that these situations were occurring. That they might be contacted by these individuals, and that in the best interest of public safety, and that's what I continue to fall back on, we didn't feel that it was in the best interest of the citizens of San Antonio to do that type of thing. All I can say is that, no just never seemed to be no. And even after they told us, we don't need you, we're still going to do our training exercise at other locations in and around the San Antonio area, but we're not allowed to do them here. Next time, I'm still getting contacted by various officials. I mean, they never would say take no for an answer.
So they weren't respecting your jurisdiction?
They were not respecting our jurisdiction. I don't think they respected our decision to go into predominantly minority areas of the city where we had vacant warehouses and buildings and try to do those types of exercises in those locations
what
in the middle of the
exercise?
Night.
Oh, I'm sorry, middle of the night?
In the middle of the night. Sometime between 9 p.m. and midnight. People become frightened. And we drew a lot of our decision-making on experiences that happened in a lot of other cities. We were very concerned with some things that have happened over there, and we didn't get any real good, clear answers.
So they were being secretive about it?
Very secretive.
And you kind of, the city and the mayor and yourself, as the police chief, you kind of felt that it was a little odd that they wouldn't trust y'all. I mean, y'all are the authorities here.
A little odd. And once I made contact with my peers in some of the other major cities, and they shared with me some of their experiences over there, the decision really was very easy. My interest as police chief is the citizens of the city.
Yes, sir.
Period. And I was not about to jeopardize the safety under an exercise of this magnitude under any circumstance.
Well, you can't say it any better than that. This isn't some wild conspiracy theorist. This is Al Philippus, head police chief in San Antonio, Texas. Oh, and the mayor, too, Howard Peak. He says that it's dangerous and that they're dishonest.
I know that they wanted to use some explosives for entry into some of these buildings, some of the so-called ceramic bullets, which would be fired into little traps, which were supposed to catch those, which would disintegrate, supposedly, on contact. Mm. But I know that in one city, American city, that one of those bullets got astray and going through a window and down almost into a restaurant. So, things can go wrong.
What city was that?
I believe that it was in Miami.
That's incredible. So, basically, right now, as it stands, and until they actually confer with y'all better or change their plans, they're not really welcome to train here in San Antonio?
We are not going to support any of their operations. They may do something at the various military bases here in San Antonio. That certainly is their jurisdiction, but we will not support any operations in the city limits.
We really count on law enforcement officials locally like y'all to protect the people and uphold the law. And again, I just want to commend you for recognizing some of the behavior of the Delta Force and expelling them.
Well, I appreciate that. Again, the decision really was not that difficult. We have the interest of the citizens of San Antonio. This is a military city. We have a tremendous amount of respect for the military and what they do.
Of course.
But I do not have any respect for the tactics that were used by the advance team coming in here.
You're saying that they were disrespectful?
Oh, they were courteous and friendly to us, to our faces. But again, when you make a decision, you try to get information to go around and try to put influence on you from pressure groups and individuals, either elected or in the community.
The interview you just saw was conducted in mid-May of 1998. Delta Force did visit San Antonio. Later the next year, during Operation Last Dance, held February 8th through February 20th, they also smashed into Kingsville, Port Aransas, Alice, Texas, Corpus Christi. That's right, ladies and gentlemen, and other towns. This is absolutely out of control. We're about to go through this story in sequential order. In some cases, especially in the case of Port Aransas, the local authorities were not even warned before massive military training, if you can call it that, was engaged in. Right here in America, it is clear psychological warfare against the police, the public, and everyone else in this nation, conditioning us to accept a militarized police state. It's basic terrorism, and I'm sad to say that about our military, but I forgot. It's Bill Clinton's military, isn't it? We can only imagine what's coming in the future with other administrations. This is an evil precedent that has been set. On the night of February 8th, 1999, right after my radio show, I got the word the Delta Force had smashed into the first of six towns, Kingsville, Texas. We got in the car, drove through the night to the South Texas coast, right in the middle of Texas oil country. It was incredibly surreal. Shades of Blade Runner.
Boy, we can still smell the fire. You fixing this area where it burned through? Hey, how you doing? Alex Jones from Austin, Texas. I got a radio show and a little TV show. What's your name?
Jerry McQueen.
Jerry McQueen?
Yes, sir.
So, you're fixing the fire damage here?
Yes, sir. Boarding up the windows and doors.
So, you're boarding up the windows and doors?
Yes, sir.
from Army Special Operations Command's work?
Yes, sir. Securing it so that way no vandalism or anything.
You're securing it, so no vandalism.
Well, they still tear things up.
So. Oh, I understand. No, we appreciate what you're doing. Just a few more questions if you have the time. I understand you're busy. Did you actually see Army Special Operations Delta Force?
I seen some of it. That was it.
What color were their uniforms?
I don't recall. It was dark and from a distance.
From a distance, you really couldn't make out their black uniforms very closely.
Yeah, it's kind of hard.
All different types of helicopters or just mainly one type?
Mainly one type that I'd seen.
Was that Black Hawk?
I'm not sure. I don't know.
Larger helicopters?
Medium size, I'd say.
Medium size. Were the police working with them in these exercises?
They had the streets blocked off.
Basically, this is a brick building, so the flammable things burned.
Yes. Just like wood and things like that, I guess.
So basically, this building is burnt out on the inside?
Yeah, basically.
Yeah.
So it's just the things that are charcoaled on the inside.
Did the military come around here afterwards and clean up all the shell casings and things?
I'm pretty sure they did.
Did you hear weapons fire?
Yes, we heard machine guns. Or we heard weapons.
You heard machine guns and explosions?
Yeah, there's explosions.
Could you see the explosions or just hear them?
You can just hear them.
Can you, I know...
I need to
oh, yes,
back
sir.
To work here.
Yes, sir. Thanks for your time.
All right.
Keith, you go around inside while I keep diverted, and I'll get us some of the fire damage footage.
Sure, give it a shot.
Well, you're looking at the upper floor, and our cameraman's a little bit nervous, as you can see, of the Kingsville Police Department's Detectives Building, supposedly deserted. We'll go downstairs in just a little while and show you the damage there, and then we'll go interview some folks around the town, from just average citizens to officials. Again, why are they practicing taking over police stations? In Kingsville, they did warn some of the officials. In Port Aransas, they did not. Again, we ought to just think about that for a second. Why are they engaging in this behavior? To condition the police as well as the general citizenry. Completely burnt out on the second floor of the Kingsville Police Department Detectives Building. Well, here we have it. Well, they've blown open the door and they're ransacking. They've come in and pulled out all the fire damage and put up new plywood over there, as you can see. That's where they came through the windows. Well, here we go through the murk, through the fire damage they've pulled out. Notice the workmen repainting the supposedly abandoned Kingsville Police Department. That doesn't make much sense to me, but again, who knows? Maybe I am a conspiracy theorist, but why was it still fully furnished with leather chairs and file cabinets and desks and computer screens and phone systems? You never know. I'm still trying to figure that out. Perhaps they wanted everything left intact so their training and their psychological test would be pulled off a little bit cleaner and smoother. Again, you decide.
See, all you're just painting over the black burn marks?
Mm-hmm.
Delta Force Munitions, a solid ceramic slug used to blast open doors. So the jackbooted thugs don't even have to hurt their feet anymore. They just got these.
Juan Garcia.
Juan, what's your position here in the city of Kingsville?
Well, I work for Malby Construction.
So y'all are just contracted out for the city to repair...
Secure the buildings, that's all. This building and the Exxon building. And that's it. I mean, that's our only job.
So now y'all are here just to secure and put the windows back in and kind of tear out some of the fire damage and things
right.
That were caused here to the police station.
Yeah, we were waiting to seal off the building. So that's all they told us, you know. That's all they, basically they told us we were going to be sitting off a building late at night, and that's all, you know. That's
after it was broken into.
Right.
Did you see what happened?
We heard gunfire and, you know, small explosions and stuff, but actually what actually happened, though, the helicopters, you know, zooming around.
Can you tell us what you saw and heard?
Basically what I saw was just the helicopters flying around and gunfire and explosions, you know. But the police were all there and they told us don't be calm, you know. This is just an exercise.
Just be calm. And yeah. Were the police working with the military?
Yes, sir, they were. As far as I know. I mean, because they sealed off the streets, you know, in pretty much in a hurry.
Have y'all fixed any bullet holes inside?
No, sir, we don't. We're not doing it. All we're doing is the exterior of the building, you know.
Was there bullet holes inside?
Yeah, we saw some. And now that's, you know, you couldn't hear very much because there was a lot of noise, choppers and stuff.
How many choppers?
I can't recall. I would say like six. I don't, you know, I didn't count them. There were small ones and big ones, so.
Oh, small ones and big ones. We were told that there were actually some attack Apache-type aircraft and then also some Blackhawks in support that were actually actually delivering the troops.
Right. I guess. I mean, like I say, I don't know the difference between the helicopters, but there was several big ones and some small ones and stuff.
So you saw several big ones and some small ones. Can you try to give us a ballpark figure?
I would say five, six, you know, somewhere on there. I don't remember.
So two or three small ones and two or three big ones?
Yeah. There wasn't very many big ones. I think there was only like two big ones. That's it. And then the rest were just small.
So two large helicopters and four small helicopters.
Right. Just black.
Black helicopters.
Yes, sir.
And you couldn't see any markings. Were there lights on the helicopters?
No, sir. Not when I saw them. Not at all.
And how low were they?
Oh, right above the building. You know, real low.
Real low.
Yeah.
And that's incredibly dangerous. Your name?
Gracie.
Gracie? Uh-huh. Gracie, you live here in Kingsville?
Yes, sir. I live in that building right there in Casa Ricardo.
Wow, you live real close. Did you hear about the helicopter assault on the old police station before it happened?
No. Until that day. There were all these over there and right there. I'm sorry.
No.
And all that time, you know, all of the, there'd been, you know, surroundings like that.
And basically, were you at home when you heard the explosions?
Well, for a matter of fact, I have gone for a walk. And I sit, and then when I got here...
Poor thing, you were actually out here.
I sit on the bench, and then I got scared because, you know, because of the noise. It was so terrible and too loud, you know.
What'd you see? What'd you hear?
Well, they were throwing some bombs, you know, bombing.
Right.
Yeah. And some, I think they were using some rifles too, and the other kind of rifles, you know, the one used to stuff like that.
Ladies and gentlemen, Gracie lives in Casa Ricarda, approximately 250 feet from the Kingsville Detectives Building, the police department. Casa Ricarda is a nursing home, an old folks' home. This lady's out for a walk, and suddenly black helicopters, men in uniforms running around firing automatic weapons. Now tell me that is not pure insanity and total disregard for the public safety. Let's continue with the interview.
Just, you know, going back and forth and doing the same thing, you know, but I just couldn't see anything else because I was so scared. I went back to my apartment and, you know. And
so you were out walking and you actually...
Well, I think it started when I got from my walk. I'm not really too sure.
What'd you see in here again?
Saying... I went back to my apartment because I was so scared, and I got out of from there because I could still hear the noise, you know. It was too loud
Make
and too
noise
fast.
Yeah,
of everything, you know. I think they were doing everything at the same time.
Explosions and firing.
And everything at the same time, and then I saw one getting down from a parachute and way over there.
You're kidding.
Yes, I did.
What kind of uniforms were they in?
I couldn't barely tell.
You couldn't really see them in the dark.
Yeah, it was dark, so it was no... Well, maybe it's, you know...
Black uniform?
Or green or something like that, you know. Like the ones that they have, the men from the National Guard. I think they're the same. I could barely tell, and I could barely tell if they were wearing, you know, something like that, like his, or I really couldn't tell. But were I saw one.
What about the helicopters?
Well, the helicopters, I don't know. I haven't seen them, you know, so close. They were so big and, you know.
What
just
flying.
Well, they look like flags. I couldn't barely tell. Maybe they were black. I don't know.
No flashing lights on them or anything?
I'm afraid they were. Between, it was 7 to 9 in the evening. 7 to 9. And it's also, it was a fire. But I don't know where. I think it was in that building.
Oh, they've already painted over it.
Yeah.
Wasn't it all black this morning?
Yeah, it's been all these days like that. I think they fixed it up. But I couldn't tell if it was, you know, right there or over there. So I guess...
Now, wait. You said you saw somebody with a parachute. Can you point the direction where you saw the guy in the parachute?
Well, let's see. Like, near the fence. Way over there.
Way a couple hundred yards over there.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Now, were they coming down from ropes or actual parachutes?
Well, I couldn't barely tell.
They were just coming out of the sky in the dark.
I couldn't tell if it was a parachute, if it was a rope. I just saw him, you know, getting down. That's all.
That is just absolutely incredible. How long did it last?
Oh, I don't know. You mean when they finish the end? I'm not sure. It's like I said, it was 7 to 9. That's what they told me there. I'm not sure.
And so it went on for several hours.
Yeah, I'm afraid so.
The gunfire and all the rest of it.
Yeah.
Well, they had trouble with their imaginary enemy, didn't they?
I guess.
Must have been many different teams.
They were using so many things that I could barely tell what they were.
So there were explosions and rapid gunfire?
Uh-huh. And they also stopped on the top of the building right there.
Which one?
That one right there, you know?
You're talking about the old Exxon building.
Yeah, that one right here.
They blew out almost every window in that building?
Yes, that's what I...
We heard that large helicopters landed on the top.
Yes! Mostly all of them, I think. They stopped right there in that building on the top.
They just landed on top of the building.
Yeah, and then they got away. They flew away. And I also saw a lot of men, you know, that I think they were going up and those things, you know.
What about the police?
Well, the police, I don't know about them. I don't know what they did. They, you know, they were just taking care of the area, that's all.
While the Delta Force did their work.
They were standing right there, and I went over there, and over here, there were a whole bunch of them. I think there were...
Did you appreciate not being warned and suddenly having black helicopters swarming?
No.
You didn't enjoy that?
No. No, not really, because, you know, I was thinking myself that they should be, you know, have done that here, because it's dangerous, you know?
Well, you know what they're doing. They want to do this to citizens in the future, martial law. And I don't want to scare you as being prepared in this country. And what they're trying to do is, have you ever noticed how if you get somebody into something a little bit at a time, they're ready to accept it? They're easing America in to it to where people are used to seeing black helicopters fly over and explosions.
I don't know. I don't know what to say about that.
Well, I'm not trying to scare you. They're not coming after you.
No, it's all right.
Don't worry, they're coming after you.
Even if they are, maybe the others, they are. They said a war is coming this way, so I don't know. Maybe, you know, they just wanted us to know, to see how, you know, how they fight in the war. That's what I've been thinking about.
You're right. They want you to know that they're ready.
And maybe, you know, if that war comes over here, that war, you know, it probably would be in the noise, you know, would be more louder and stronger, you know?
And again, your name one more time?
Gracie Longoria.
Gracie Longoria?
From here, from Kinsville.
Well, God bless you, and we appreciate
you. Well, God bless you, too.
Right here in Kingsville, Texas, every window in the Exxon building has been smashed out. Every single window. And they've come in and boarded up every single one of them. This is from the explosions. They came and blew a hole in the roof, we're told. And the large helicopters landed here, again, at the Exxon administrative building that's been shut down for some time. Blew a hole in the roof and inserted troops inside and practiced killing the evil terrorist. And the police, again, were nearby helping as the relationship was growing. It's so much fun. Well, the entire front entrance that we're told was glass and metal by the lady across the street who will not speak on camera from the Kingsville Publishing Company, the local newspaper, the Kingsville Record, says that, yes, this was all metal-trimmed glass windows and the entrance right here were all blown away. Only Imperial stormtroopers are so precise. That's ridiculous. They blew out every window in the structure. Look at it. Must have been some powerful explosives. I'd like to see the inside of this building. And again, you got the newspaper right across the street, won't even talk to us. About the reporter that allegedly had his camera stolen.
Judy Hayes.
Judy Hayes, Alex Jones, nice to meet you.
Yes, sir.
What's your position here?
I'm the lieutenant in charge of the patrol division.
Oh, fantastic. All I want is like a 5 or 10 minute interview. Is there a place we can sit down? And
I'll answer a couple of questions for you. And
okay.
Then I have to be on my way.
I understand. Everybody's busy, and I appreciate you doing this. Can you say your name for the record and then spell it?
My name is Judy Hayes, J-U-D-Y-H-A-Y-E-S.
Thanks a lot. We also make documentaries, by the way. We're told that Monday evening of this week, there was a Delta Force operation from Fort Bragg, otherwise known as Army Special Operations Command. Can you tell us how many helicopters were involved?
I can tell you that Monday night there was a joint training session between the United States Army and the Kingsville Police Department. The Army was doing some sort of extraction type thing. They used 8 helicopters. Our training involved sealing off the area as if we were involved in taking care of a hazardous materials incident. So we were rerouting traffic and making sure that there was no civilian foot traffic in the area. So we got quite a bit of training in that area.
Did any of your SWAT team, or I see you have 2 officers, look like they're SWAT trained, did they assist the Delta Force in any way?
The only participation on the part of the Kingsville Police Department was in a hazardous materials training session. We did not participate in any way with what the Army was doing.
Well, that's very helpful. We're also told that they were firing ceramic bullets.
I have no idea about anything that the Army was doing. It would be a situation in which you would need to contact them.
Well, yes, in Fort Bragg. Now, the mayor had stated, or his office had stated, that it was secret. But what y'all are saying is it was secret up to a point, and then the police department went around and actually warned the citizens in the immediate area downtown.
I have no idea where the word secret came from, and I'm not going to respond to that. All I can tell you is that we did plan with the Army on this in order to get our training for hazardous materials, and we did warn as many persons as possible in the immediate area and then moving out until we had to take our positions in order to take care of traffic flow.
So actually, the night of the event, several hours previous to the 8 helicopters coming in, y'all did warn the general public in the area?
We most certainly did.
Are you familiar with the chief of police of San Antonio, Ali Phillips?
No, I'm not.
The deputy chief is, and we're told the chief also knows him. I went down and did a breaking story back in May of 98, where he threw out the Delta Force, and I have him on tape. They attempted to bribe him. They endangered public safety. Many areas have let Delta train, but are you aware that in Miami they fired a bullet into an all-night restaurant?
I haven't got any idea of what you're talking about at all. And that includes any operations by anyone of that name. I know that we worked with the Army.
Yes, Delta Force. Are you aware that it is highly dangerous to have helicopters at those low levels, especially that many in a small area?
I think what you need to do is to talk to people who have training in that area, and I would again refer you to the Army.
Okay, one of my last questions, and I do appreciate your time. Was there any money given to the city by the U.S. government to be able to carry out this exercise?
I think you would need to talk to our finance director on that.
Because the chief of police of San Antonio and the mayor talked about, again, the attempted bribery and the cash money gifts to people and things. That's why it really became a big stink. It was in their paper for quite a long time.
I can't comment on that kind of thing. I'd have no knowledge of it whatsoever, and I've referred you to who you need to talk to.
Hi. Hi, my name is Alex Jones from KJFK Radio in Austin. I also have a little TV show. How you doing? Is the mayor in today?
I'm not sure. You may want to check his office. It's straight in.
Mm-hmm. Is this the mayor's office?
City manager's office.
City manager's office.
Is he in?
Yeah, he is. He's on the phone right now.
I'd just like to ask him two or three questions.
Okay.
What's your name again, sir?
Carlos Lerma.
Carlos Lerma?
Yeah.
Well, it's good to meet you, city manager. We'd just like to ask you some simple questions. Hope you don't mind if I sit down. I'm very tired. I've been walking around talking to people on the street all day. We're just curious about Army Special Operations from Fort Bragg coming here, Delta Force.
Uh-huh.
And we'd like basically to ask some questions about was the public informed beforehand? Are y'all aware of the 10th Amendment and Posse Comitatus and things like that?
No, I'm probably not aware of the 10th Amendment, but I made the decision not to inform the public because we would have had thousands of people around this area here and would have been a lot harder to control.
Oh, I understand, sir. I wasn't trying to be sarcastic when I said it.
I didn't think you were. I didn't think you would.
Yeah. Well, I mean, certainly you are aware of the 10th Amendment, though. It's states' rights. And it's also Posse Comitatus is concerning federal troops working with local law enforcement in any area is expressly prohibited. And I'm not accusing you of doing something wrong. This has been done in literally hundreds of communities.
Uh-huh.
I don't know if they told you that you were the first when they came here.
They told me I was the first of some current events or current exercises that they're going to have.
But you chose, just so it wouldn't be a public health risk, just so it wouldn't endanger the public, to not tell the public about the operation that was held here Monday.
That's right.
We were told at a local grocery store, some people thought the bank was being robbed.
Well, the bank is very close to here, you know. But the police were fully informed of it. They knew. As a matter of fact, they used an exercise to secure an area where we might have a hazardous material escape, like from a railroad tracks. We have trains that carry some materials that could be hazardous to you, and sometimes the hazardous are an accident on the bypass. So they practiced an exercise to secure an area.
Oh, so local law enforcement actually worked with them?
Yeah.
Actually worked with
Special Forces.
Special Forces from Fort Bragg?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Delta Force?
Yeah.
Looking out your window and seeing unmarked helicopters and troops dressed in ninja black suits with assault rifles, it's kind of spooky.
Well, I agree with Mr. Sanchez, head of emergency management in Clyburg County and in the city of Kingsville. And he wasn't warned. Neither was the county commissioner's court or the county judge about what happened in Kingsville. 4 days later, in part of Operation Last Dance, Port Aransas got a little visit, and the Mayor Glenn Martin, was not pleased.
Nobody wants to get in their business, but we ought to be able to answer questions, especially when they're, you know, flying at dangerously low levels and alerting the citizenry.
We contacted the mayor of Port Aransas, and in the Corpus Christi Caller Times, he was also quoted as saying he was not warned of the impending raid. It can be termed nothing less than actual terrorism against the American people. By definition, terrorism seeks a political aim by scaring a population or a group of people. It's plain for all thinking people to see. America is in the process of a radical change, and I'm afraid to say it's not for the better. Alice, Texas was next on the list for Delta Force training. And one of my listeners on my radio program dropped by and talked to the police chief of Alice, Jack D. Compton. And what he found out was interesting. A very key piece of information came out. Foreign troops were involved in at least the Alice operation. You see, Jack D. Compton's comments didn't make much sense until about a month after Operation Last Dance, when Anniston, Alabama got a visitation by 800 Rangers accompanied by Russians. You'll find out later they actually turned the power off the part of the city because they felt like it. But let's go ahead and talk to the chief. Then we'll go and show you where Delta engaged in some of its training, literally 100 feet from a backyard where children were at play.
You know, they need these trainings so specialized, and what exactly the qualifications are that they need to train so much.
In the event of any terrorist activity, these are going to be the men
that address it. And they need to keep their skills honed to a razor edge. They have to. And they don't have time, the luxury of time, to plan an operation and go in. You know, can't plan forever. They've got to make a move and make it fast. And, so time is of the essence, and having their skills up to a high level is very important. But these are the people that you're going to call on for any of your terrorist activities.
But who are the terrorists? It's certainly not Bill Clinton giving all of our nuclear weapons designs and enabling systems to the Chi-Coms. No, no, no. It's people like the Davidians or Randy and Vicky Weaver at Ruby Ridge, Idaho. Yeah, we're the terrorists. We're the danger. We're the threat because we won't submit to total domination, total control, total slavery. Waco is a sterling example of this, the lies and corruption that were evidenced during their activities. Oh, but I forgot, we had to save the children. That's why we burned the 17 little children to death. Again, to save them from the terrorist, the deadly, dangerous terrorist, their parents.
Can you tell us some of the, not necessarily some of the specifics, but some of just certain reasons why, you know, it's... they need these trainings so specialized, and what exactly the qualifications are that they need to train so much?
In the event of any terrorist activity, these are going to be the men that address it. And they need to keep their skills honed to a razor's edge. They have to. And they don't have time, the luxury of time, to plan an operation and go in. You know, can't plan forever. They've got to make a move and make it fast. So time is of the essence, and having their skills up to a high level is very important. But these are the people that you're going to call on for any terrorist activities.
Well, yes, these are the people we're going to call on for terrorist activities. Delta Force, BATF, FBI, hostage rescue teams. They're training on military bases as we speak, ladies and gentlemen. They trained back in 93 before the assault on the Waco church. That's right, it's not a compound. We need to get our priorities straight in this country and worry about our real national security risk, the real threats to our nation, like Bill Clinton, and the already forming global government that controls him. That's the crisis. That's the threat. Not our nation's people. Not American. Speaking of global government, let's go back and hear from Chief of Police in Alice, Texas, Jack D. Compton. As he admits, foreign troops were on the ground during the training mission in Alice, Texas, during the terror mission in Alice, Texas. Make no mistake, that's what it's about. Again, training police, training the general public, training the military, that working together for national security is a wonderful thing. I'm here to tell you, historically speaking, it is nothing less than a nightmare. Governments are the most dangerous creations on earth that are man-made. We've also learned that citizens in Alice were told that if they came outside their yards during the training exercise, they'd be taken to jail. I mean, this is getting more and more insane. The Bill of Rights is being flushed down the tubes.
This government is training other so-called friendly countries, or...?
They are training friendly countries, and I'm not at liberty to give you their names, but I know that they are.
Mm-hmm.
And it's...
They were there in Alice, or, you know, a couple weeks ago?
They were some present, yes, sir.
Mm-hmm.
They weren't involved in the training itself. They were there on the sidelines.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you just heard it. A police chief in a South Texas town, Jack D. Compton, saying that he's not at liberty to discuss information engaged in supposed national security operations. What a convenient umbrella for the unfolding police state. But there's one problem with that whole argument. Why are foreign troops in almost all of these exercises, according to my sources? Why are they allowed to see all this secret activity? But the American people, in many cases, aren't even warned in the name of national security, because people like Walter Szulski, spokesperson for Army Special Operations at Fort Bragg, has stated many times in many publications that, well, we can't let the public know because we have to protect our tactics. Oh, I see. The foreign troops aren't your enemy. You just got to protect your tactics from your enemy, and that's obviously the American people.
Can you describe how many, and describe also the helicopters that were there?
Well, the helicopters were Black Hawks, and they came in blacked out. We didn't see them except for the skylight, and they were completely dark. And some of the Delta Force people rappelled down the ropes to the helicopter. I mean, from the helicopter to the top of the building. Some landed there on the ground in the parking lot of this building.
Was there any that hovered like above the building? And if so, how high?
Only long enough. They was probably around 75 to 100 feet, but they came down on the ropes. So once they had ejected, the helicopters left and came back in a few minutes and picked them up. Mm-hmm. So they didn't go back up the ropes. They were picked up helicopters on the ground. The noise level was not excessive. Inside that brick building, the noises were muffled. You didn't hear a great deal. And the loudest noises didn't come from explosives. They came from what we call flashbangs. That's a distraction device that makes an excessive noise and a very bright flash. The charges they used to breach doors that are just enough to breach the door.
They were just coming and dropping off people and bombing and shooting their guns, and that's it.
They had guns?
Yeah, they were just practicing. Like, they had closed up all the roads and everything.
Did you see any men? What kind of uniforms they had on?
Nah, they didn't let us get out of our gates, because if we did, they said we would be arrested.
Did you see the Alice Police Department there?
Yeah, they had all the roads blocked.
Uh-huh. So they were like working together?
Yeah, they were, and the sheriff
was there?
And the sheriff was there.
The J.E. Poultry Company, an abandoned poultry plant, was the site of Delta Force training in Alice, Texas, literally smack dab in the middle of a residential area, as I said, where children were at play. You know, I wish I could say that these operations were just a blunder, a irresponsible activity on part of the Department of Defense. But ladies and gentlemen, it's clear it's being done on purpose. And don't forget Gracie. She lives in Casa Ricarda, a retirement home that was right across the street from the detective's building, the old detective's building in Kingsville. Old folks' homes, residential areas, all part of training the American people and police to accept visitations by black helicopters bearing armed men in black ski masks with automatic weapons. Again, Americans are being designated as the new threat. Not the Chi-Coms, not the Russians, not the socialists that are running this nation. They've taken over, my friends. Unfortunately, the strange military activities are not localized only in Texas. They're happening all across the nation and with increased frequency. Literally hundreds of so-called training missions terrorizing the public. You heard the police chief of Alice, Texas, tell us that, well, there were some foreign troops, but I can't talk about it. Well, the sheriff, Larry Amerson, sure talked about it from Anniston, Alabama. He wasn't told that 800 Rangers with a contingent of Russian troops were going to be visiting the Anniston Municipal Airport. They didn't even warn the public when they turned the power off, not by accident, but on purpose. Again, if this doesn't make it clear this is out-of-control psychological warfare upon the American people, psyops testing, I don't know what will make it clear to you, America. This is a crisis of pandemic proportions. Imagine sitting down to have dinner, and suddenly the power goes off at 9 o'clock at night. A few minutes later, you hear automatic weapons fire. You walk outside, black helicopters, structures on fire. That's what happened at the Anniston Municipal Airport back in March of 1999. And again, the sheriff was not even notified, Larry Amerson. But our good friends, the Russians, it was okay to tell them all about it. And they were even allowed to join in on the fun, the terrorizing of the American public. Thank you, Bill Clinton. Lest you think it's just special operations from the Army and the Navy that have been engaging in this treacherous activity, think twice. The Army National Guard is engaging in the same type activities, minus the live fire and burning structures. But when it came to the practice takeover of a private civilian airport, all the same, in Temple, Texas.
So, are y'all just in support of the takeover of the airport?
Yes.
That's what they just told us over there. So,
yeah.
So, yes, y'all are just supporting the officers in the takeover of the airport.
Yes.
And we were told it could be for here in the U.S. or overseas.
Possibly.
Really? They tell you all that, huh?
Yeah, we're just working out of it because we have aircraft. We're supporting the aircraft, so you have to have an airfield. So we're just...
Just getting the local authorities used to working.
Yeah.
Working together.
Hey, Mac. Are we talking to anybody? Are they supposed to have public information on
me? Oh, I'm sorry.
Our soldiers are not authorized to make any comments on any of our movements.
Oh, okay. The soldiers aren't authorized to talk to us?
Only our colonel, Lieutenant Colonel.
Were y'all out here when the Czech troops were here?
Yes. They were here in, when was that? Wednesday.
Oh, the Czech troops were?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
What were they doing?
They just, I think they were just stopping by. I don't know.
They were just stopping by?
Mm-hmm.
Y'all are just Army Reserves, aren't you?
Yeah, we are Army National Guard. We're here for 2 weeks, 18, Temple, Texas.
So basically, this isn't a Delta Force operation?
No, it's not.
Not a Delta Force?
No.
You know, they visited Texas back in February.
Yes, uh-huh.
There were some buildings that got burned. The police chief threw them out in San Antonio. Alley Phillips, he's former Army Intelligence, just like the military.
Yeah.
They fired in an all-night restaurant, too. Kind of a big stink.
Yeah, I think the best way if you find out about the Czech is when I operation people down here.
Operation people?
Yeah, in the front. You know.
So basically, y'all are just on maneuvers. I live in Austin, and I literally saw, it may have been the same helicopters, but over a three-day period last week, I saw hundreds of helicopters. I even saw a Russian Hind. Are y'all practicing in those or something?
No, we're not.
I heard we missed the Czech troops.
The Czech troops?
Yeah, we heard there were some Czechoslovakian troops here.
Oh, yeah, there were some Czechoslovakian officers here.
Oh, really? What were they doing, just checking out how the U.S. operates?
I'm not sure. They were with the Public Affairs Office out here.
Oh, really? What's your name, sir?
Major Canyon.
Major Canyon, what is the exercise y'all are conducting here at the Temple, Texas Municipal Airport?
Okay, we're here acting like we're being deployed and occupying an airport, and then staging out of here and operating our missions out of this airport.
Did you get that, Mike?
Yeah.
Anyways, but of course this is overseas.
Either overseas or something local.
So, are y'all just in support of the takeover of the airport?
Yes.
That's what they just told us over there. So,
yeah.
So, yes, y'all are just supporting the officers in the takeover of the airport.
Yes.
And we were told it could be for here in the U.S. or overseas.
Possibly.
Really? They tell you all that, huh?
Yeah, somewhat. You know what I mean?
I think you guys are kind of smiling, but, well, I tell you.
I can't tell you anything any more than he could.
We have aircraft. We're supporting the aircraft, so you have to have an airfield, so we're just...
Just getting the local authorities used to working.
Yeah.
Working together.
Hey, Mac. Are we talking to anybody? Are they supposed to have public information on me?
Oh, I'm sorry.
Our soldiers are not authorized to make any comments or any of our movements.
Oh, okay, the soldiers aren't authorized to talk to us?
Only our colonel, Lieutenant Colonel Shine.
Okay.
Upon entering the once civilian terminal at the Temple Municipal Airport, we were told to leave. Though politely, it still points to something ominous.
We're just here for a 2 week period.
Oh, just for a 2 week period? How long ago did y'all move in? About a week ago?
No, we're here for 2 weeks at a time.
Oh, cool.
Who you with?
Oh, I got a little radio show, a little syndicated talk show, and I also make documentaries.
Thank you.
How you doing?
Pretty good.
So y'all are just practicing taking over the airport?
Can I introduce you to somebody that...
I've already talked to you about this.
Yeah.
We're a fraction occupying an airport.
Yeah.
The station taking over.
Okay.
And we're going to have a meeting in here, so we please ask you to leave.
Okay. Leave the municipal airport? Sure, we will.
No, leave the terminal building.
Leave the terminal building. Okay, thanks a lot.
Okay.
Appreciate it. Thanks for the help.
The place is Hebron, Maryland. The date, September 3rd and 4th, 1998. Another one of my listeners in Hebron, Maryland, sent me this amateur videotape and accompanying news articles. I called and confirmed his story with the sheriff and others in the town. The Marines came in, over 70 of them, and engaged in a takeover of the town from the courthouse to other centers of city government. And then they went out during the day and at night and engaged in mock gun confiscations, aided by citizens and, yes, even adolescents and young children on bicycles looking for the supposed terrorist. All part of training our law enforcement, our military, and our local constabularies all around the country that it's normal activity to have children and others engaged with the military tattling on citizens. This is nothing but pure preparation for martial law. Again, Hebron, Maryland, 1998.
Are you the sheriff?
Yes, I am.
So tell me what's happening here.
Oh, my God. I'll have to repeat this again, though.
Well, some of it, a little bit. It won't take too long because I got some food over there waiting for me.
Oh, have you?
Yeah.
They just got a military exercise training that's being conducted in a civilian population in full support with the community, with the sheriff's office.
Oh, yeah, you fully support it?
Absolutely.
And what is the purpose of it?
It's to give these young Marine second lieutenants an opportunity for some real-world training with... non-combatants who have never been exposed to something like this, so therefore they're not choreographed in any way.
They haven't been exposed to this kind of training before?
No.
Well, aren't they going to be going door-to-door to a few houses?
They are going door-to-door to some houses, but they're going door-to-door to houses where the people in those houses have already volunteered to be a part of the training exercise.
And what are they going to do when they get to the house?
That I'm not sure. They can talk that over with the people that have volunteered, but they're going to be going no houses or no place in town that where there's not a volunteer spirit.
But they're going to do gun confiscation, right?
Oh, no. Not weapons. In my town.
Weapons?
No gun confiscation. No.
Well, they're going to confiscate artificial weapons.
Well, if that's part of the training scenario, but they're not taking any civilian weapons.
Well, but they're taking what is supposed to be, right? Mock weapons as if it were the citizens' weapons?
Now, that I'm not sure of. But, if they are, it's a part of their training scenario and their items that they have brought as part of their training equipment.
Right, but they're training in order so they could confiscate weapons.
I think that's the case, yes.
Yeah. You guys are using the ladder instead of like climbing by a rope or something.
Ladder's quicker, easier to get gear up to the roof.
Would you have to carry it through the field if you were like really...
Well, the idea is that since we're in a town, we were able to get one in the surrounding area. If you had to get up on the roof, you have another method.
Huh? Yeah.
I can't hear you.
You're also going to see plain-clothed Marine Corps spies going around coordinating the operations, coordinating local police, the military, and the tattletale citizens to deal with the deadly, dangerous terrorist right here in America.
Hey, is the patrol going out right now? Are they going to do the house call, or are they just going around?
Hey, we got another patrol going out. The first patrol doesn't know anything about the house call. Just leave them alone. They'll get to the house call on time. Roger that.
Okay, I'm just trying to figure out who we need to walk with.
Yeah, you're walking. You're going to walk with. You're going to walk with.
Hey. Just going to go with the... Don't help me get the right one.
For the next
Well, you just heard it for yourself. The United States Marine Corps, with plainclothes officers wandering around, talking about house calls.
You go over here with
the
information.
Yeah,
and if the building looks much bigger than the industry, so you think it like that big two story building.
We've got a couple more batteries in that, bro.
The amateur cameraman that got us this footage lives in Maryland. He had every right to get this footage, but once the sun went down, the local police and the military did not want him to get some of the key footage, the raiding of the homes. Again, what do they have to hide?
As far, what, tell me about the insurgent thing where they're going to do that stuff. What are they doing with that?
Okay, we have four individuals running around the town that are just basically acting as aggressors, bad guys. And their mission is, once the officers and lieutenants come in, their mission is to go out and seek these insurgents, see if they can locate them, and remove them from the population.
And they haven't started doing that yet?
No, not at all.
Oh. And what kind of stuff are they going to do? Like, act like they're shooting at you and stuff like that? Or?
Yeah, basically just a typical Marine training exercise. They have weapons. They'll be firing blank ammunition, just basic urban patrolling.
Just be doing that out in the street and stuff. And tell me about the door-to-door stuff that you're going to do to, like, was it four houses or what?
It's four houses.
And what are you going to do?
Well, what we're going to do is we're going to plant some rubber weapons in there.
Uh-huh.
Toy guns, per se.
And you're just going to go into regular citizens' homes doing this?
Actually, the citizens have volunteered their services. They volunteered to be role players.
Uh-huh.
And they've allowed us to use their homes.
And what are they going to do? Are there any of them are going to act like they don't want you to do it? Or?
Yes.
Well, they're all going to act like they don't want you to do it.
Well, some are going to be friendly, some are going to be belligerent, you know, some are going to be uncooperative.
Uh-huh.
That's the scenario that we'll be training.
Oh, and it's just going to be the people that live in the house that are doing this?
Correct.
This role playing?
Right.
What about their kids? Are there going to be kids in the house?
The kids are more excited. I don't think the kids, maybe, there might be a few kids running around, whatever, but, you know, the kids.
But now, what are you going to do? Are you going to arrest the people?
Are we going to arrest the people?
Well, or act out that you're, whatever.
No, sir, we're not going to arrest anyone.
What are you going to do to them?
Nothing. Go up to them and ask them questions, see if they've seen any subversive activity. You have to understand, these people have been versed in their roles.
Yeah, I understand. I'm not, like, but you're going to, like, I mean, they're going to say, when they're resisting, what are you going to do? Are you going to grab them, like, and stuff? Or?
The people aren't playing the role to be resisted, sir.
Oh, they're just going to talk stuff, but
not... They're just civilians.
Oh, yeah. Well, I didn't know if they were going to act like they were resisting, and you were going to act like you're... like arresting them or shooting them or
no, we're not assaulting anything.
So are they going to pull weapons on you or anything?
No, sir.
Oh, okay. And then what's going to happen besides that, then? But what about the rooftop stuff?
The rooftops?
Rooftop? I don't know. I heard
what
you doing.
Rooftop?
I heard you guys were going to go and take over buildings or something, maybe from the insurgents or something.
Don't know anything about it.
Oh, don't know anything about that. So maybe that's just whatever happens is whatever the insurgents decide to do or something?
If you don't mind me asking, where are you from?
I'm from Baltimore.
You're from Baltimore?
Yeah. Baltimore, Maryland. Not that far.
Nice town.
Yeah, it's a pretty nice town.
Thank
I gotta get used to looking at this camera, it's weird.
Again, this is amateur camera work, and for some reason the cameraman didn't really know what he was videotaping, but upon speaking to him later in depth, it was clear the entire day small children again were aiding the United States Marine Corps in tattling and looking for the subversives. This is right out of Mein Kampf, ladies and gentlemen. This is Nazi-esque behavior. The tattletale police. Imagine Marines in your backyard, in your front yard, walking down your streets in the middle of the night. Well, you're a patriot, aren't you?
Well, I certainly am, but this is a deadly, dangerous precedent that's being set. They're brainwashing our military. Now, if they had nothing to hide, I'm a little confused by their actions. The police began to get more and more aggressive as the night wore on, simply because this average Joe Q citizen was trying to catch some videotape of the bizarre activities.
Oh, nothing. I just said I didn't have it on then anyway.
I was talking to you. I didn't have it on.
How you doing?
Good evening.
What's that?
It's a good evening.
How you doing, that, sir?
Very good. Yourself?
How you doing?
Not bad. Were you the same guy that was here earlier?
Lesson number one, never turn off the video camera, even though you feel intimidated. I've seen this, I can't tell you how many times. Sheldon, the amateur cameraman, turned off his camera when confronted by the sheriff's deputy. And yes, ladies and gentlemen, look right there on your screen right before he turned the camera off. A Marine with a fully automatic weapon. The point is, you see the relationship building here. Sheriff's deputy and military officer. Now, let's try to figure this out. Just for a second, are they going to load our police up with our Marines on C-130s and fly them overseas? Just a question I have.
Where are you going, mate?
Where am I going?
Hey, where
am I? What do you want? About what?
About your activity.
What's my activity? What's wrong?
I need to speak with you.
Well, I'm doing something.
I'm doing something too. I need to talk to you. Come on over here. I'm going to bust out.
Why are they around my truck?
I'm not going to buy any truck.
Well, they're... What do you want?
Sure.
Have I done it?
All right.
Sure.
Take the video camera off.
Okay. What do you want?
Down.
What is your point?
The video.
Well, that's America. You just saw the camera shut off. He was told if he did any more videotaping, he'd be going to jail. And there's the police officer that told him to turn his camera off, getting multiple visitations for walking down one of the main streets of Hebron, Maryland, in the state where Sheldon Green lives. I've gotten a chance to get to know Sheldon long distance since I got this tape almost a year ago. He's a great guy, being treated like a criminal for only asking questions and videotaping the urban warfare training and disarmament scenario. Turn your camera off while the Marines check out your truck. Right there in black and white night vision video for you. Well, here we are in Northern California in Oakland. And the Marines have come in for Operation Urban Warrior, what should be deemed Operation Desensitization of the population. And they have their role players, they have their fake camps set up, you name it. We're going to take you in and show you what's happening.
Honoratus, Aperit altum, Tohor in tur, Nimis exaltatus, Presentem in venti, Secape apruti.
Well, I think terrorism is being practiced on the residents of the city of Oakland, because many of the retired teachers, retired military people have informed me that they understand what's going on, and it's not anything that relates to humanitarian training whatsoever. This is a psychological, as we in the research community say, this is a psyops. They're preparing people for what is coming, not what is being presented today.
So you're saying they're preparing people to accept it with incrementalism?
That is correct. Like the old frog example. You know, you put the frog in the water and you just gradually continue to raise the heat on the water until the frog is cooked. And that's the way it works. The problem is that the local people, people in general, just will not take their heads out of the sand. And they don't realize that when the head's in the sand, the other part of the body is totally exposed to problems. And I don't care. If I'm just the only person screaming like the voice in the wilderness, if I'm only the Paul Revere of Oakland, I'm going to tell everyone I can, listen, we have a serious problem.
And it's called a police state.
It's called a police state.
After all the evidence you've seen in the last hour and a half, how could you deny what's going on? Well, if this hasn't convinced you, get ready. Local police in Alameda and Oakland working with the military, the U.S. military, the U.S. Marine Corps and Urban Warrior, as well as foreign troops, ladies and gentlemen. That's right, foreign troops right there on your screen. And having, speaking of screens, computers, satellites, tracking and watching. Meanwhile, the cameras are going up. It's time for us all to realize what's happening here. There you have it, tracking the population. My friends, this is totally unconstitutional, and looking at a historical reference, it is terrifying to see military working with police, then you add in foreign troops, paid actors saying, we're Americans, you can't do this to us. They're conditioning the police, the military, and the public. Think about it. It's clear the American people have been designated the enemy. I'm sorry, ladies and gentlemen, it's the federal government that is destroying the sovereignty of this nation, the United States of America. It is their problem. They're the crisis. They're the threat. They're the terrorist. And I'm sad to see our military and our police being merged, and to see them changing from peace officers and defenders of the country into thugs and bullies for the bureaucrats and their foreign banker globalist controllers.
It would be a microchip or a monitor that would be placed on each Marine that would monitor their vital signs. You work the same way as the person locators would thought that, where a doctor or a medic or a foreman could monitor from a safe distance everybody's vital statistics, their blood pressure, their heart rate, their body temperature. Why is that important? The way it works now is when a squad goes on patrol, we'll have a medic with them.
They're expecting resistance, and what they get is CNN with cameras.
That woman lives there. Maybe her children are home asleep. Hey, they're going in there. I'm going to go in and rescue my kids, right? In the past, that might be interpreted as a hostile act. One of the technologies or what makes you nauseous. In the past, in a situation like that, she might have been shot. In the future, we want to give our Marines non-lethal options where they can say, no, she's not armed, maybe threatening, but I don't want to kill her, or I don't want to kill him or them. Use your sound wave rifle, I guess you could call it, and down they go.
You guys have heard of the sticky gun?
Yeah.
I'm sure you've seen that. Trying to come up with new stuff now for crowd control, etc. We've got a group of civilians that keep trying to break through a barrier. Instead of unloading with a saw into them, you just have a sticky gun. All of a sudden, boom, they can't move. All kinds of things the Marine Corps and the United States military is trying to do to minimize the amount of people that have to be killed.
Yeah, him in prison, huh?
Now you're going to see an execution.
So you can see, she went running in there saying, I live here. Oh, but there's a prisoner.
I'm a hopeless mom.
Typical of what you see in an urban environment, people hanging out, doing nothing. And as we know, idle time is the devil's hands. Right? We've been saying people don't have jobs, they don't have a home to go to, or a home that they want to go to. So they just hang out all day long. You have a local religious leader over there and the nun. You have a church right here. You have some Marines conducting an interview over here, it looks like. Right now everything's calm. Everybody seems to be content. But at any minute, this could erupt into a riot.
We were in Oak Knoll for 5 days in Oakland, California. But the footage you're seeing was amateur. You see, the media was taken on a stage tour. And you'll see some of our footage later. This is the guided tours for the public during the exercises. And when the Marines have a problem, or when the police have a problem dealing with the civilians, they call in the backup, and the battle begins. Oh, by the way, I hope you enjoyed seeing the foreign troops earlier, helping keep the Americans under control.
Due to the large number of people arriving, you will experience a short delay. Please remain calm and cooperate so that we can process you into the camp faster. Attention. Due to the large number of people arriving, you will experience a short delay. Please remain calm and cooperate so that we can process you into the camp faster.
Hey, don't come on. Hey? Jellicle. Yeah. What's up there? They need to see me. Hey, I want the duck in the carpet. But duck. Niet hier op dak, niet hier op dak. Nee, mag niet uit. Ze moeten gewoon de dak in de gaten houden daar.
Wat jij?
Now watch how they treat this civilian. Boom! They kick him. Get out of there. He scurries past the foreign troops from the Royal Netherlands, and then they, in SWAT team style, stacked up, get ready to raid and kick in the doors. Besides, these people are lazy. They have to be dealt with. You heard the Marine Corps officer earlier, didn't you? I'm very glad to see that the humanitarian assistance is going well. When the police can't handle it, they just call in the foreign troops. Everything's okay, working together, speaking English, speaking foreign languages, working with police, speaking English.
Hey, otherwise we're going to overwhelm them, you know.
tolerate civil disobedience. Attention, attention, attention. American forces are here to help. Please, please remain calm. We will not tolerate civil disobedience.
Let's move. Let's move. We're right in the middle of the experiment. Need you to move. Need you to move. Oh, look. I need you guys to move, man. I'm not saying it.
Zoom in down there.
Notice the defensive posture, ladies and gentlemen, of the tanks surrounding the camp. We were run off during our staged guided tour. We were told later by internal sources they were staging a defense of the camp. Someone was going to try to free people, and that can't be allowed.
How's it going over at the camp?
Well, pretty well. The guys are in a bit exercises now. They do pretty well.
So the camp situation is going good with the disarmament and things?
Oh, yeah.
Because we saw them over there disarming people. Is that what the exercise is?
Yeah, exercise now, yeah.
Fantastic. Where are you from, sir?
Well, Holland.
Oh, okay.
From the best Marines.
Now, this poor fellow is going to be taken into the mock police station, handcuffed, and then transported to the camp for his best interest. Again, he must be a dangerous extremist. I have rights. I have rights. Please. I have rights. Ah, staging for a big offensive against the civilians. It's so much fun.
Yeah, it's motion. It's fucking track sniper fire. Sniper round lands near it. Automatically track. Oh, is that
going to be inside standby for the helicopter? Yeah, we go from here to the
ground. There, sir. Place the cover on the deck of your feet. Move your backpack. Place the backpack right next to the cover. Take a step backwards.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to introduce you to Colonel Love.
Sir, is this where you take the digital photos?
Yes, sir. That's the station where we take digital photos here. I send them straight to over to Sergeant Smith, and he processes it, and he puts them on ID cards, sir.
Oh, so the people coming into the camp get ID cards?
Yes, sir.
City of Green.
Who's the mayor of Green?
It's George Brown.
We have someone reporting to be the mayor of Boolean. Do you know who the mayor of Boolean is?
Jerry Brown.
Can you tell me where you acquired the helmet?
Someone just gave it to me. I just put it on.
Where did they give it to you?
It was laying on the field, and someone just handed it over to me. I was in the run.
Where
we got on the helicopter.
Well, as usual, the Army officials would not let us view the entire interrogation. As you heard, they told us to get out of there.
You guys know what I'll take care of to process the camp.
Camp, there's a few rules and regulations that you must abide by. One of them, no weapons is allowed upon board the camp. This ID card that you have on your person needs to stay out where we can see you. These are the only means we have to identify you. Okay? If you have family members, we need you to keep your family members together as you are ultimately responsible for them. And if you have any questions out there, please ask one of the Marines. Feel free to ask one of the Marines, and they'll be glad to help you answer any questions you might have.
Can you say that one more time again? I just missed the first part.
If you have any questions, please contact one of the Marines out there, and they'll answer any questions you might have. okay? Shower hours are going for children from 4 to 6 p.m., for women from 6 to 8 p.m., and for men from 8 to 10 p.m.
Okay? Well, thank you very much. You've been very informative and very courteous. I really appreciate it.
No. Thank you much. People Does anybody have any questions?
What are the camp rules one more time?
There's a few regulations you must abide by while on this camp. No weapons will be tolerated on the camp, and no disturbances will be tolerated on the camp either.
Do you have some way to quarter or corral these folks?
Yeah, that's another great question. I've got to tell you that in an actual environment, we would work very, very closely with local government. If this was a domestic crisis like an earthquake or a fire, then we would be working very, very close and hand-in-hand with FEMA and the American Red Cross, for example. And they would be in here helping us, or we would be actually helping them. If we were doing this, let's say, in a Somalia or a Bangladesh or some other foreign country that had invited us in, then certainly we would be working with other non-governmental organizations and private organizations and certainly government organizations.
International, like the United Nations?
Certainly. You bet. We would really be here to provide support to them. Is there a concern that they may be terrorists or someone who might not be welcome in the camp, coming into the camp? Yes, certainly. That's why the first thing we do is we make sure that there are no weapons coming into the camp. Once they get into the camp, they'll come through the processing tent, but we do get some information from them so that we can track other family members. We talk to them, and we would certainly try to identify any known or suspected terrorists and separate them out from the rest of the group. We actually have a place where we would separate them. There are collection points where we would collect enemy prisoners of war, and then they would be evacuated to the rear.
Oh, to a secure facility.
To a secure. Sure, we want to protect them too.
Okay, who do you need to
speak? I need to speak with Major Braddock or your security chief. Your security chief, Mueller. All
right. Can you find out for him?
I need to get to the town mayor. She's in a meeting.
Okay, let's go ahead and bring those two in. You need an escort for that? Take it.
Got it.
Yeah, we're going to get fed.
Thank you.
You need to get fed. We're going to get fed.
Let us out.
Let us out of here. Come on.
You can get off the screen.
Yeah. Can you point out the enemies on the screen?
Yeah, again, here's the red icons are an example of an enemy unit there. And again, we're using MIL standard 2525 symbology, which is a little bit new to the military right now.
And that's the criminal group?
Well, again, it could be an enemy unit or it could be an unknown unit. It could be just a civilian group. We don't know. Again, it depends on how it's reported, and that's just an example.
So this is the criminal group. This is the terrorist group. This is a civilian group. This is an infantry unit. Who's the infantry?
Could be an enemy infantry unit, unknown size and type.
Okay.
If I see a group of enemy infantry and I don't know what size and type it is, it's just an unknown enemy unit.
So we've got terrorists, we've got criminal groups, we've got infantry groups, and there's an armored vehicle that the enemy has?
Correct.
Okay, these guys have plastic handcuffs available. You see it in the gentleman's mouth right there. He's got a plastic handcuff. These are handcuffs that are used to control dissidents. You see he's turning it into a handcuff by looping one through the other. And they'll be used to put on a person's hands. Basically, this is a place where people are identified. Here's the plastic handcuffs right here.
We're interfering with the exercise at this point, okay?
They won't tolerate civil disobedience. This is a place where they're going to use the plastic handcuffs. Again, you see them right here in the soldiers' hands. This is where people are restrained, identified as possible terrorists.
Let's go, please.
This is a site that we've been warned away from by the people operating this. They don't want us to see people restrained in handcuffs. This is something that they don't want us to be able to video.
I'm not going to bring a foreign officer up and have me insulted. Okay?
Insulting?
Yeah.
Who did I insult?
Well, I'm not saying you did, but you're getting close, okay? So I'm not going to do that. If you're going to interview me, I'll be more than happy to do
that. How did I get close? I mean, I'm just curious. Yeah.
You're asking, you know what you're doing. So that's all I'm saying.
I was asking about the UN.
Okay. I will get a foreign officer for you. And he was on UN duty.
So a lot of the older people are getting out of the Marines.
Basically, it's all going to a younger type of person.
Oh, they've actually changed.
Well, it's mainly more young people are being involved with the new time of change, a change of time.
So, guys, is the main assault about to start?
Pretty soon here. Pretty soon.
So they just basically let us see the soft stuff, huh?
Right.
You said right?
Yeah.
So y'all are about to go in and take out the terrorists, huh?
Pretty much, yeah.
Pretty much.
Who are the terrorists? Who's the main complement of terrorist?
What's that?
I mean, basically, we just saw the soft stuff. Y'all are about to go in and do a major assault?
Exactly, yeah. We're going to go in, we're going to hit the terrorists, take them out, they've been causing some problems, roll them with the vehicles for support.
Who are the terrorists?
Who are the terrorists?
Yeah.
They got a faction in there, it's causing some trouble.
Is that the orange?
What's that?
The orange group, you're green and they're orange?
The green or the green for us.
So basically, what's going on right now? The other forces can't handle it, they're about to send y'all in?
Exactly. One bot's going to be sending us in, and we're going to hit the last two buildings where the faction's going to be held at. And we're going to rush in there with our scouts, we're going to hit them hard, take them out.
So y'all are doing almost like a SWAT-type city exercise.
A raid.
So you're doing a special weapons and tactics.
Exactly.
Just like police, but with bigger, more firepower.
Pretty much like SWAT. We're going to go in, we're going to raid, we're going to hit them hard, and then we're going to pull out.
So y'all are going in to kill. This right now is peacekeeping that's going on right now. Y'all are going in to kill...
Terrorists.
Kill terrorists, right?
Exactly.
Wow. That's something else. Mike, let's climb up there. I don't know if I'm getting all this.
Sure.
I saw some people being arrested and frisked and slammed down on the ground down there at the base. What's going on there?
They're probably most likely just giving up resistance, saying, you know, we don't want help. They're probably pushing people around, stuff like that.
Oh, so if during the evacuation period...
You can counter hostiles.
So they forcibly take people to the camp?
If they're being hostile, yes.
What about the folks that are wearing black and are posing as police officers? What's their role?
I'm not sure.
They are police officers. To my knowledge, those are police officers. Oakland Alameda Police.
So they're police action?
We have full support for this training operation from Oakland Police Department, basically.
Yes,
from
sir.
All the civic people here. So.
Oh, I understand that, absolutely. Marines are just training with the Alameda Police Department.
That's more than likely what's going on there, just to get used to working hand-in-hand with the police force, since that's a lot of what goes on in today's world.
What would you do if people in America were upset about getting their weapons taken away? Would you guys ever go and help the government take their weapons away? Well, we don't have to have this.
I won't answer that question.
Okay.
We'll turn the camera off.
Well, that's Oakland, California, ladies and gentlemen. Now let's go to some listening devices, cameras on the street corners, and armored personnel carriers in the hands of your local police.
So, officer, you're on the Austin City SWAT team?
Yes, sir.
What type of vehicle is this?
Called APC, Armored Personnel Carrier.
Armored Personnel Carrier.
Donated from the military, donate that, Jeff?
Yeah, all the free goodies. There's a lot more coming, don't worry.
It works fine.
Is this your Kevlar helmet?
Yep.
Pretty effective?
Yeah.
Can we look at it?
Sure.
Boy, it almost looks like a German helmet.
Yeah, I think they're actually a military surplus, so it's playing them back.
Police departments from the smallest to the largest all across the country are receiving free military surplus, helicopters, APCs known as armored personnel carriers, and much more. A deadly trend that is expanding. But it's not just armor that local law enforcement, from state agencies to local police departments, are getting. No, my friends, it's listening devices. Of course, the excuse is to find the location of gunshots. But the designers openly admit it can also be used to listen to your conversations and triangulate your position. Just consciously think about this for a second. Listening devices. and I almost forgot, in tandem with cameras. All federal funding. Repeat, all federal. Armored personnel carriers, helicopters, foreign troops, practicing with local police, with our military. And in Austin, Texas, and many other cities I've visited, I have noticed that many of the cameras aim into the neighborhoods. I'm not kidding. Time and time again, they are not focused on the highways and byways, but into neighborhoods. And then you've got the checkpoints. Those can't be ignored. Warrantless searches, random searches. Can't be called American. More akin to some foreign third world dictatorship. Every day I see families, black, white, Hispanic, it doesn't matter, being pulled over, being searched at random. Police have requested to search my vehicle, and in all of the four or five cases, I've told them no, but once I had to get somewhere, so I said, you know what, go ahead and search the vehicle. But you're thinking the media will keep you abreast of the situation? Well, my friends, you're looking at a FEMA control box. That's right, at 98.9 KJFK-FM, where I work, in Austin, Texas. That, my friends, can take over the radio station. It is radio controlled by a FEMA tower. That's right, a FEMA tower in New Braunfels, Texas. It covers almost all of the central part of the state of Texas. Little teletypes come printing out of the side of the machine weekly and update us. In the past, it was voluntary. Now it's mandatory, and they can remote control take over the station. But again, I guess they've only got our best interest at heart. They are the globalists. They are the people that know best and understand how the world needs to be managed. They would never hurt us. Oh, that's funny. Why did they slaughter between 500,000 and 800,000 people in Africa, in Rwanda, back in 94 through 96? And I guess they do know better than our own Congress, our own House and Senate, how to run the nation. And if not, well, they'll just supersede the Constitution with executive orders that their puppet presidents will pass. They're the power. They're the elite. They're the enemy. But even the United Nations and the World Bank and the IMF and the rest of this global gang of thugs are nothing more than puppets. Puppets to the financial interests that control them, like the World Bank and the IMF. Massive foundations, as we speak, according to the Washington Post, are moving forward to destroy the Second Amendment. People like George Soros pumping tens of millions of dollars a year into the movement to disarm the law-abiding citizens and give the despotic government free rein to enslave us. Bill Clinton kisses mothers and gives weeping speeches, chiding how evil the gun industry is. The same gun industry that supplied the weapons that helped us defeat Hitler. Oh, and don't forget all the celebrities like Rosie O'Donnell and Janet Reno, the Butcher of Waco, coming out and saying you should have to have a federal license to be able to have a gun. Sharon Stone saying she's giving up her right to keep and bear arms. What choice words from the actress. And Spike Lee saying we should kill, quote, shoot Charlton Heston and dismantle the NRA. Funny, Spike, I thought you were for nonviolence. Why did you say we should shoot Charlton Heston with a .44 Bulldog Magnum? I'm having a lot of trouble figuring this out. Oh, I'm sorry. You're an elitist bootlicker, aren't you? But this is a global problem. In England, they're getting ready to restrict the right to a jury trial to most of the population. The U.S. is moving forward in joining the U.N. International Criminal Court with a tribunal, not juries. And the satellites are going up. And back to America with the thumb scanners, the retina scanners, the national ID cards, with your bank accounts, your insurance, your life history, all on one government-issued card. Think of the power and control it's going to give them. And by the way, it's already being implemented in places like New Jersey or Texas.
I'm not a criminal. What's this for?
Then why do you need to mark him? Why do you need his...
That goes right into the FBI.
Because Bill Clinton says I'm a criminal. Because we're standing up against this...
Lest you think it can't happen to you, I simply spoke out against the thumb scanning that's going on in Texas, and I was taken to jail. And what happened to my cameraman of over 5 years, Mike Hansen? Now that's really sick. Mike Hansen, no criminal record, veteran, father of two, happily married for 15 years. Well, Mike paid the ultimate price. He simply refused to let MJTF search his vehicle in a parking lot. And so they busted out his window on him and his 11-year-old daughter, searched the vehicle, found nothing stolen, but that didn't stop him from taking him to jail, according to Mike, and beating him and torturing him. The moral of the story, America's in a police state. We better stand up and speak out and wake up the good police that are left out there. Knowledge is power. That's as old as human history itself. And our enemies know that. They have most Americans and the rest of the world locked in a mind-numb stupor, a false reality.